Are you sick and tired of being sick and tired? It's been said that an apple a day keeps the doctor away, or does it? I was feeling so bad. I asked my family doctor just what I had. It's time to get a new prescription for your life. Get ready for your daily dose of Healthy Talk Radio, the show that's empowering your health. And now, here's America's health and lifestyle coach.
This is the show where your health is your wealth. Thriving is more important than just surviving and the only thing lost are those unwanted pounds. Healthy talk radio that helps you get well, stay well, and live well. It's your healthcare on demand. Everything you need, we have there for you. Of course, our lifestyle providers, healthcare providers to help you, our clinics, the Center for Lifestyle Medicine, our all original programming, television, web, podcast, our radio shows. We're developing brand new content for you. New shows are coming out, all health related to impact your health and your life. That's what this show is about. That's what we're about. Leading the way to help you have a better lifestyle, to live a better life, and to thrive and not just barely make it. Gallbladder is a big deal. What if your doctor tells you just get it cut out? Oh, it's no big deal. You don't need it? Well, we do need it. We were given it for a reason. You can live without it. Yes, you can. The body will compensate. But the gallbladder is pretty amazing at what it does. Let's talk about it for just a second. A lot of people don't really know. So we pay attention to all the other areas. But what about the gallbladder? Okay, what it does, it's a little sac underneath the liver. Stores bile from the liver. It's a little substance. And the gallbladder releases the bile in the cystic duct into the small intestine to help break down the food you eat, mostly fatty foods, okay? So typically the gallbladder doesn't cause too many problems for a concern, but a lot of times it can slow or block the flow of bile from the gallbladder. A number of issues can result and lead to gallbladder disease. So what can happen is cholelithiasis, which is gallstones, and it's a common condition where these small stones or sometimes larger ones develop in the gallbladder. The gallstones then can cause pain, what we call biliary colic, and about 90% of people with gallstones will have no symptoms whatsoever, but most symptomatic gallstones have present in a number of years. So for unknown reasons, if you have gallstones for more than 10 years, they're less likely to cause the symptoms. But the biliary colic is a term often used by severe episodes of the pain, that cramping that you get in that right side down by your rib cage. That's what that is. So an inflamed gallbladder can also happen, inflammation of the gallbladder. Cholecystitis, it's caused by gallstones, excessive alcohol use, infections, or even tumors that can cause the bile buildup. And the most common cause of cholecystitis is gallstones. And the body can react to gallstone irritation by causing the gallbladder walls to become swollen and painful. And the episodes of inflammation can last for several hours. So it's pretty amazing how that happens. Dysfunctional gallbladder or chronic gallbladder disease is another one too. And the symptoms are a lot more constant, but tend to be vague, including abdominal fullness, indigestion, and increased gas. So a lot of the bloating and all that happens, that can be a big deal. So here's some of the symptoms, okay? If you have some of these symptoms, you may have a little bit of a gallbladder condition that you want to check out. Severe abdominal pain when you eat. Pain that may extend beneath the right shoulder blade to the back, referred pain. Pain that worsens after eating in a meal, like fatty foods. Pain that feels dull, sharp, or crampy in that little area down by your rib cage, right side, okay? Pain that increases when you breathe in deeply. Chest pain, heartburn, indigestion. Excessive gas. Feeling of fullness in the abdomen. And a little bit of jaundice, the yellow of the eyes. That can happen too. And if you get stool of an unusual color, like a clay color, that could be an issue as well. So just keep an eye out on it. If you have those kind of symptoms, you know, talk to your doctor. It's important. Very, very important. 888-283-7272. But don't get it cut out, by the way, unless it's absolutely necessary. If it's just casual, like it's bothering you, there's some sludge in it, get multiple opinions before you do that. You don't want to jump in and just automatically have it cut out. That's unless it's an emergency, unless there's a big stone blocking the cystic duct and it's an emergency, really take some time and think about it. It's really important, that's for sure. 888-283-7272. That's 888-283-7272. Check us out. Newsletter goes out almost every day. We've got videos that are out to help you and coach you and encourage you to help you along the way. Really cool stuff. That's what we're about. Your healthcare on demand. All right, let's go to Diane. Hi, Diane.
And I'm living with four comorbidities: diabetes, asthma, arthritis, third stage kidney disease. If I'm correct about it, I think all four are inflammatory issues. And I heard you talking about the amino acid address on the computer, but I'm wondering, with third stage kidney disease, would that be a problem? I know amino acids are proteins, and so the kidney thing is my biggest question.
Yeah, amino acids are your building blocks, right? Those are proteins. And when you eat a meal, like if you ate a piece of chicken or fish, then you get amino acids from that. Protein's important. It's vital for the body. An overload of protein is the concern with the kidney. So I wouldn't be so concerned about amino acids. You can get that from your food as far as taking like a supplement. You definitely want your nephrologist to comment on this just because that's what they do. And if you're under that care, I would mention to them, you know, they're going to give you a diet, like a kidney supportive diet, okay? And in that, they're going to give you certain amounts and ranges of food you can have and ones you have to stay away from and phosphorus and all you know, phosphorus-containing foods. They're going to give you a list of that. And you want to follow it. So I wouldn't worry about taking extra supplementation. I would be concerned about getting the highest quality food you can get. So for the protein that you do take in, you want to get it from a high source. Okay, that's really the big deal. You want to make sure you're getting it in a great way from good food sources. So I guess what I'm saying is don't get it from junk. You want to get it from the right source in the right way that will support your body in the best way. Okay, because it really does. It makes a difference. Quality is extremely important. 888-283-7272. Give us a call or go to the website. We're here for you each and every day to help you with your health and your life. That's what it's about. That's what we're about. So restaurants now are cutting calories in kids' meals, which is kind of a cool thing. Popular restaurants have cut calories in children's meals and are offering some healthier side dishes like fruits and vegetables, a new study shows. And the industry has started making some changes, but it's focused mostly on calorie improvements are needed to consistently offer healthier combinations. So at Tufts Friedman School of Nutrition in Boston, the investigators looked at online nutrition information, children's meal options for all the fast food chains. And the study looked at it, and according to the results, 72% of fast food meals and 63% of sit-down meals had 600 calories or less. So they're encouraging the people and the different companies to lower the calories so that we don't create more of the obesity epidemic in our kids.
To find out more, connect with OnCall Radio online at InShapeNetwork.com.
Check us out on the web. I'm America's Health Coach, here to help you each and every day and encourage you and take you to the next level with your health and with your life. Let's go to the phones, talk to Martha. Hi, Martha.
I'm calling about neuropathy. My husband has horrible neuropathy and leg cramping. And
well, with neuropathy, one of the big things with that and the leg cramping, one of the big things you got to look at are any type of vitamin or mineral deficiencies, and they're very, very common. Okay, matter of fact, all of the standard medical text in the research, we know that a deficiency in B6, and there's different types of B6, but a deficiency in B6 can really make the difference. And so what happens is with B6, it's called pyridoxine or pyridoxamine, and when that gets low, that can lead to neuropathy. Now, other things, of course, can cause it, such as diet and diabetes. I mean, there's a lot of conditions that can cause neuropathy. You could just have a lot of DJD, degenerative joint disease, in an area, and that could be a reason too. But I would look at the deficiencies, have some blood testing done, and figure out what the root cause might be, and see if that can play or see if that can make a difference by looking at the different deficiencies to see if they're there. Okay, because that, a lot of times, that is the root cause. And when you build those areas back up, including omega-3 fatty acids, so getting the omegas checked can also help tremendously. So I would look at that as well, okay? 888-283-7272. That's 888-283-7272. Give us a call or go to the website. Are you a runner? You might want to think about it. Running now, they're saying, can add about 3 years to your lifespan. It's just pretty cool. So runners live an average of 3 years longer than people that don't run, according to new research. And some people may say, well, I don't like running, so I'll give up the 3 years. But it's actually good. I mean, even small amounts of running can help. They don't have to run. You don't have to run a lot to get the benefits. Matter of fact, the study author in this was a professor of kinesiology at Iowa State University. He said, if you start running and continue running at an attainable health goal, it's not clear, they said, whether the longer lifespan is directly caused by running. They have to say that. U.S. guidelines, though, is 75 minutes of vigorous activity, which is about 30 minutes of moderate intensity most days of the week. But most people who exercised less than that still receive significant health benefits. See, if you just get out and get moving, that's what matters. If you just get out and get your body moving, that can make a huge difference. So if you run less than 51 minutes, fewer than 6 miles, slower than 6 miles per hour, or only 1 to 2 times, was still associated with solid health benefits compared to no running at all, which is pretty cool. So this was all looked at in the Journal of the American College of Cardiology. And so the study involved more than 55,000 adults aged 18 to 100, and participants were asked to compete or to complete a questionnaire about their running habits, and researchers kept track of those who died during the study period. But the researchers discovered that people who didn't run had a life expectancy 3 years less than that of runners, and running was linked to about 30% lower risk of death from any cause and 45% lower risk of death from heart disease or stroke compared to no running at all. So even less avid runners receive significant benefits, running a minimum of 30 minutes to 59 minutes each week, which is about 5 to 10 minutes a day. Not that bad. I mean, if you just get on the treadmill and run 5 minutes, really, and you get these kind of health benefits, that's not a lot. So to get out and start doing that and start keeping your body to a place where it can run and you can stay active can make a big difference. I'll tell you that along with running, yoga is a great type form of exercise to keep your body strong and to keep your body in rhythm where it needs to be. I mean, longevity with yoga is extremely powerful of what it can do. Really is. And in Greenville, South Carolina, there's a Dr. Michael Scott Emery. He's the co-chair of the American College of Cardiology Sports and Exercise Council, found a little surprising that 5 to 10 minutes had such an impact. He's like, I can't believe that basically this is enough to create the impact in people's lives. Very, very good. And it's true. Just get out, get moving. Running, though, is powerful. It's something that I've always included in my routine. 888-283-7272. That's 888-283-7272. Lines are open. Give us a call or go to the website. Let's go to Mark. Hi, Mark.
24 years old. I've had a bad back since high school, and I was just wondering if there's anything I could do naturally to reduce the pain and inflammation. It's pain in my back goes down my legs and sometimes up into my neck.
Yeah, there's a couple of things you can do. In lifestyle medicine, the way we look at it, you've got the structural aspect of the body. So the spinal column, and you can have, of course, when pain is there, that's your foundation. So you want to make sure the spine's working right, that the nerves coming out of the spine are working effectively. There's no restriction or really inflammation is a better word around that. DJD or degenerative changes that can happen around the disc is something that needs to be looked at as well. So to make sure that everything's working effectively is key. That's why I'd get it evaluated. Osteopathic physicians, chiropractic physicians, those are both great options to figure out a way to really see if the body's working at its peak level. That's one of the main ones. So I would look into that first and see, because they can do some basic studies. You can do MRI, you can do x-rays, and really get a good overview about what's going on inside the body from a solid perspective that can give you the help that you need. But I would do that first, because the back pain and neck pain can be treated. In our practice, the Center for Lifestyle Medicine, in our clinics and our providers, can make a tremendous difference over a short-term period of care.
In my opinion, Theralac is the best probiotic on the market today. Probiotics and a healthy gut are essential to feeling great. For the best in probiotics, visit Theralac.com. That's Theralac.com.
To find out more, visit the show online, InShapeNetwork.com.
Want to get your health right, your lifestyle is your medicine. So the choices we make every single day, they matter. But getting the kind of body that we want, getting healthy like we want, comes down to some simple, basic principles that we need to follow. Now, a lot of times I get asked the question about getting healthier, getting fit, getting the abs, dropping the belly fat, and getting fit, right? So to get in fit is to be in shape. And being in shape is a great concept, because when you're in shape, you feel good. When you're in shape, you feel good about yourself. When you're in shape, you feel strong, right? Strong is the new thin. Strong is where it's at. So we want to be strong. We want to be athletic. We want to be agile. We want to be in a place where we can really function well, right? So to be able to function well is to be able to thrive is where it's at. And that's the key. So how do we get there? The question is, how do we get there? How do we manage that? And how do we get our bodies the way we want it? To that level, in that place, it's important. Well, I'll tell you one of the big keys, and we're going to talk about that today. I've been wanting to talk about this for quite some time just because our hormone levels, if they are not right, I'll tell you this, I get people that come into our clinics. We coach people all around the world. Our video coaching and our telehealth that we use. And we have clients all over, patients all over. And in one of the big outcries is, I eat right, I follow your eating plan, I exercise 5 to 6 days a week, I use resistance training, I do everything right, I've got my macros right, and I still can't lose the belly fat, or I still can't lose that last 10 pounds, or I still can't get my body where it needs to go. It just doesn't look the way I want it, right? So you're not in shape the way you want to be. And there's the key to that. So you have to figure out exactly what it is. It comes down, I'll tell you this, many times the baseline of that comes down to hormones. You have to get the hormones right. When the hormones are right, you are right. Okay? When your hormones are right, everything's working the way it needs to. Hormones are the key. And testosterone is the big one I want to talk about today, because women have testosterone just as much as men. In men, it's our primary hormone. All right, guys, it's what gives us our drive, our drive for life, our sex drive, our libido. It gives us focus and energy, all that, right? With women, it does the same thing. It helps with their sex drive, gives them drive, purpose, and can do all that. So there's ways to help raise testosterone. Low T is what we call it, but low T or low testosterone has become a significant health challenge in our nation. It really is, and around the country. I mean, the higher the stress levels are, and over the years, it seems like testosterone levels have gone down even more and more. So we want to figure out ways to get testosterone levels up so the body's functioning at a higher level. So number one, to do that, you have to reduce your stress level, number one. All right, so reducing the stress level is the first area that needs to be looked at. Both physical and emotional stress is super important. So when your body goes into survival mode, the last thing it worries about is sex. Okay, so when you're in survival mode all the time, the body's not going to think about it. So you reduce the stress level. So we're talking about low T. A lot of times people will say, well, my sex drive or my libido's gone down. So Roy Trambler, he's the director of the Mount Sinai Diabetes Center in New York, said as the stress hormone cortisol goes up, the testosterone hormone goes down. You can't have both. So natural stress relievers like exercise will improve your mental health and keep your testosterone production up. You want to aim for about 150 minutes of aerobic exercise each week, or 75 minutes of higher intensity. All right, the second thing you want to do for testosterone to help you get in shape is you want to get rid of that spare tire, get rid of the belly fat. And when you get rid of the spare tire and the belly fat, guys, this is a big one for us, because the extra weight around your waist. Remember, your waistline is your lifeline, right? So if you have extra spare tire on your waist, it'll contribute to lower testosterone. As belly fat increases, the activity of the enzyme aromatase increases too. And this aromatase converts testosterone into the hormone estrogen. So the less testosterone and more estrogen causes fat to build up in the breast and the hips. So to determine your healthy weight, learn how to calculate your body mass index. And every point you knock off your BMI will help your testosterone level improve. That's a big one. So maintaining good heart health is another one. Anything good for your heart health is good for your testosterone level too. So maintaining good cardiovascular health means reaching and maintaining a healthy weight, regular exercise, and eating a heart-healthy diet. The best exercise for low testosterone is a combination of aerobic exercise and weight training. I mean, those two together are great. They really do. They make a huge difference. We see that with clients all the time, patients all the time, and it's one of the number one prescriptions that we use in our clinics for lifestyle is simply getting the exercise, the aerobic exercise, and a higher intensity style of weight training. It stimulates these hormones to be produced in the body. And the best diet really is one that's low in, well, moderate in protein and has a good amount of carbohydrates and moderate in the fats. Okay, you do that and you'll create really, really good balance in the body. I can't tell you how much our eating habits really make a big difference. Zinc is a really important supplement for us to use too, because zinc is a catalyst in the cascade for making testosterone. It's one of those key minerals that we just don't get enough of, and stress will destroy zinc. The higher our stress levels are, that's why you see a lot of people that, a lot of cold remedies for people that, have little colds and flus. If you go to the store and you get anything natural, you will see like the zinc supplements. A lot of the supplements contain zinc. And the reason for that is that the zinc, when it gets low in the body, it will cut down our immune system. Well, the other thing is when zinc gets low in the body, it will cut down your overall production of testosterone. So you have to have high levels of zinc to, or at least good levels of zinc to actually produce the right amount of testosterone in the body. So that's extremely important. So you want to make sure that you got plenty of zinc. That's really important for testosterone levels. We're talking about getting in shape. And so if you want to get abs, if you want to get lean and you want to be stronger, testosterone levels have to be at a good level. You can't have low testosterone and build a strong, healthy body. It's the main hormone that our body needs to do that. And I see guys in their 30s and 40s with testosterone that's all the way down in the hundreds, right? And I don't think you need to jump straight into the hormone replacement therapy. Yes, I know you're thinking that right now, but you don't have to do that. You don't. Your body can produce it. Your own body can produce enough testosterone for your body to get in shape, for you to be athletic enough, and for your body to do well. You just have to make sure the overall environment, the overall picture, okay? So we're talking about you maintain good heart health with regular exercise, get rid of the belly fat. These are all ways to raise your testosterone level. Reduce your stress level. Emotional stress leads to low T. So you got to manage that and get out of survival mode. Now, you got to rule out sleep apnea and make sure you're getting really good sleep. So a good solid 7 to 9 hours is definitely what's needed. Matter of fact, when you cut back on your sleep, if you cut back, like let's say, to 5 hours of sleep and that's it, you're going to cut your testosterone by 21%, guaranteed. It's all in the research, all in the studies. So if you're not sleeping, your testosterone levels are already going to be down. Go easy on the alcohol too, because what happens is, like belly fat, too much alcohol causes testosterone to be converted into estrogen and can contribute to the low T. So the high quantities of alcohol over a long period of time can be toxic to the testicles and decrease production of testosterone. So alcohol can also interfere with the signals between the brain and the testes for regulating testosterone production long term. So they're saying no more than 2 drinks a day. Keep it simple. Don't use the drugs either. Okay, opiate drugs, marijuana are all linked to low sperm production and low testosterone. If you want to keep your T up and you want to maintain healthy body fat levels and really get your body leaner, then you got to be careful with the opiates and that sort of thing. So I would be cautious of that. And finally, you want to avoid self-treatment for testosterone. So if you think you're low, don't get an over-the-counter supplement. All right. The FDA has pretty much removed a lot of the testosterone-raising supplements used by bodybuilders. And really, if you're going to do it, go to your doctor if you want to. But when you're getting in shape and you really want to get in shape, you can check it out, to which is really a powerful tool. We have a whole entire program and system to get your body in shape, to get you healthy from A to Z, to walk from having no abs to abs, to be able to live the healthy lifestyle, to get healthy and strong. Remember, healthy is strong. And that's what we want to do, is create that strength for you to be able to give you the help that you need right there at In Shape University. You can check it out. Just go to the website. Powerful tools. Hormones are powerful. But if you follow these tips that we talked about today, you can keep your testosterone levels up, which will give you the strength, cut down the body fat, and also give you the tools you need for a lean, strong body.
Connect with OnCall Radio and watch OnCall TV at InShapeNetwork.com.
Back to the show. Check us out on the web. We're here for you each and every day to help you thrive and not just barely make it, but to do well and to know that your lifestyle is your medicine in so many different ways. So I'm real big on foods and healthy lifestyle choices that we make each and every day, but I'm also real big on making sure you have a clean environment in your home, right? Because personal care products, your cleaning products, and there can be a lot of things lurking as far as bacteria goes that can be hurting your health, mold as well. So here's some of the germiest places in your house that you're not really cleaning. So it's easy for bacteria and food particles to get trapped in these crevices, but sponges in your kitchen are one of the most breeding grounds for bacteria. So try antibacterial sponges and dish soaps that limit the lesser bacteria of evil. So you want to be careful of that. But if you have a microwave, you can actually stick the sponge. You soak it in bleach, stick it in the microwave for a short period of time. You can microwave on high for 2 minutes, and it will kill 99% of the bacteria. It's pretty cool. Drip coffee makers. So even though the coffee itself has some antimicrobial properties, those drip coffee makers need to be cleaned. If you don't do that, it's just a huge breeding ground. So you want to run a 50-50 mix of water and white vinegar through the machine once a month to help cut out the mold that can be in there. And you let half a mixture run through the machine, switch it off for an hour before finishing the cycle. And don't forget to clean it about once a month. That's another one. In the bathroom, what about that bath mat that sits there on the floor? Pressed against the floor, dark, damp environment, a lot of mold builds up in that. You can launder that mat once a week on the highest heat with bleach, and that will kill the majority of the bacteria. Laundry baskets are a big one too. So your sweaty workout clothes, underwear, all that can throw constant bacteria in there. So what you can do is use a bag for the dirty clothes, one for the clean stuff, one for the not clean stuff, and also keep something for things that are wet so they don't just sit there and sit for days as they dry. That's a breeding area for the bacteria. On the go, you got things like headphones. And again, stick them in the gym bag and they're sitting around with the bacteria. You can actually clean those and get just a gentle soap and water mix and wipe those down, which is a good idea. Keys are another one. You know, simply can disinfect the keys. Well, a lot of people don't think about it, but there's a lot of bacteria breeds on that just by the keys sitting around and whatnot. But the other thing too is that's interesting, handbags, yoga, your exercise and workout mats, you just wipe these things down. Just don't leave them. You can use a little bit of bleach and water mix, or if you want to go more on the natural side, there's some great products at most of your health food stores now that are natural cleaning agents, okay, that are really good. That can be very, very helpful. Shoes are a big one, though. I think shoes are underestimated. Studies found that shoes contract significant bacteria indoors, infecting clean floors. And some researchers have found that shoes are more specifically transport E. coli and bacteria and can cause things like pneumonia. So what you can do is take your shoes off before you enter the home and have a no-shoe policy inside the house, and that tends to help. So just some basics that you can use to really help. But keeping the place clean is important. I mean, it's not like we got to live in a bubble, but you want to do everything you can to keep the bacteria levels and keep your environment as clean as possible. Let's go to the phones and talk to Nancy. Hi, Nancy.
I have an 8-year-old son who has an issue with body odor, particularly in his breath and his bowels, and I know that is very likely a digestive concern. I'm wanting to know what we can do to modify his diet in some way. He's a good eater, eats really healthy food, but what we need to be doing to modify his diet.
Yeah, there's a lot of things you can do. You want to focus on gut health. Anytime there's any type of odor that's going on, you focus on the gut health. Gut health is everything, all right? Stinky gut, stinky breath. Stinky bowels, stinky gut, okay? They're all connected. So you just want to look at things like probiotics, which you can get. And I like Theralac. You go to Theralac.com. Great probiotic that can really get in and do the work. The other thing, too, is this really important that you want to look at is fermented vegetables. And so if he's into like kimchi or you want to try that out, a lot of the fermented vegetables can be really good. And then fermented dairy products. So a lot of the fermented dairy products are super to be able to use. And I would consider that. I would start doing kefir, which is really good. Great source of probiotics that can help quite a bit. So I would jump in and look at that. It's a great way to start getting the things you need as far as the bacteria goes. Because once you start building the good bacteria up in the gut, that's when everything starts to clear. And what you'll notice is, even with body odor of any kind, most of it, once you start having really good bowel movements and non-smelly, non-odorous bowel movements that really don't have a smell to them, that's when you'll notice a big difference. And that just comes with time. So you have to make sure that the gut is healthy, and that comes from the foods and even the right kind of bacteria. Puts another hour in the charts. I want to thank our producer, Jay Patrick, engineer John Garrison, and the rest of the team. Go tell one person something you learned on the show. Together, we can transform the health of our friends, our families, and our communities. You're listening to the show. It helps you get well, stay well, and live well. We're diagnosing hope one person at a time.
This show is designed to provide accurate information of a general nature on the subject matter covered, and given with the understanding that neither the host nor the station is engaged with rendering any form of medical advice, diagnosis, or treatment. This information is not approved by the FDA and is not intended to diagnose, prevent, treat, or cure any disease.
To experience more of Asa Rx Audio, visit us at asarx.com.